Ed, I have a question about the textbook reduction items. There's a substantial number of that's pretty significant. So just the impact of that, and is that sort of, is there some interplay with how curriculum is being taught now online, or what resources teachers, like what are the implications? That's a lot of money.
Yes, and again, similar to the way we're looking at supplies, we're under the scenario of preserve current textbooks, so we wouldn't be replacing necessarily textbooks with new editions, but some have outlived their useful life, so maybe replacing current editions, which is typically at a lesser cost. So we're holding in place, with the exception perhaps if there's the enrollment for the mathematics finance course, mm-hmm. that would require new textbook series. But in other content areas, it would be current editions, no updates to the editions that we currently have.
Okay. Is there, like, this may be more than you are prepared to say now, but are there, there are online tools with every textbook.
Yes.
Are there less expensive options to update software that are those tools as opposed to replacing the whole textbook? Or, I mean, obviously the model for the textbook companies is to keep you buying more stuff, but, you know.
My experience and understanding, and if I go astray, I'll ask Mr. Jensen to correct me. Typically with a new textbook series, you can purchase web access, but that's at an additional cost. It's not part
of it. Oh, it's not part of the cost,
and
okay.
As far as I know, you can't upgrade it. You have a textbook that's 5 years old. I don't know if we can upgrade and include web access, and if we can, again, it's going to be a substantial
I see. So it's not reducing costs for us, the idea of having things online.
I was talking with a couple of my teachers, and I thought that would be the case.
Right.
If we buy new textbooks, and we'll throw in the web access.
No.
I don't believe that happens, at least not in the last couple of years.
Do we have a given rotation in each department, so each department knows what year they're more likely to be able to get textbooks, or doesn't that work? Mm.
The short answer is not really. It depends on a lot of factors. If there's a new textbook that comes out, it really checks off a lot of the boxes for a content area. A faculty member will be interested. A lot of our faculty, as you well know, are highly experienced and trained, and we don't rely on the textbook as much as other faculty. Also, they'll be able to create their own materials. Mm-hmm. For example, in some of our science courses and our language courses, not a lot of need for textbooks in our math courses and kind of our algebra, geometry, and trig. Everything comes from the modules, so there's not as much of a need for a textbook there. So it really varies by department.
My personal experience was to try to have a cycle. It doesn't work anymore. Right. So just to read.
Diane?
Could you talk about the clubs? For me, clubs are something that comes to our attention quite often. There's always a need for new clubs or a want for new clubs. Students' interest change. So this would be reducing some clubs that the attendance is low. Would that also end up being like a change in policy? Like obviously you wouldn't be able to add new clubs unless something else would fall off the list, or like how would that affect that entire clubs?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think as a rough screen, one could look at attendance and participation in our co-curricular activity. I wouldn't want to say that that's the only criterion that one would look at, because I would recommend or would suggest that there are some clubs that we want to have in our high school, no matter what the attendance is.
Sure.
More depth there.
Yeah.
I think, I haven't thought about any proposals for adding new clubs. I haven't had any more this year. But if we're in a scenario where we're removing some clubs based on low attendance, I think I would need to get some thought, and I need some guidance in terms of a procedure to propose a club.
Because right. There is a long process for getting a club, so you may want anyone to start that if there's no hope of
ever
getting a club.
Correct. And there's, it's human nature, and we're dealing with great adolescents. Everybody's interested and enthusiastic, but they're very highly scheduled, and sometimes their schedules can't accommodate what they want to participate in.
Sure.
So there's a gap there as well.
Okay.
A follow-up on that. Thank you for this information about attendance at all.
That in Excel.
That would be helpful. But I'm I just want to understand how I'm reading this. You've got dates of meetings for these clubs, and there are numbers of kids in a box below, but also in that date. Oh, maybe it's not the date. It's the date that's dropping the number.
Yeah.
Got it. So in AV, it's not 11-1, it's 11-13. Got it. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, that's where it's all in
words. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks for also for the extracurricular activity participation numbers. But I just want to just share my view, of course, just to acknowledge that I think, the decision making around cuts in which clubs, how that happens, is in your hands in consultation, obviously, with Joe and your teachers and whatnot. So I just want to, acknowledge that at this moment, that while that level of detail is useful for us, in many ways just to show how active and engaged our student body is, but that I would just want to say that, I respect the fact that it's your decision to make that process.
And just another note, you may notice in terms of some trends, once the drama club begins their rehearsals, some of the attendance in other clubs.
Sure. Okay, right.
After April 8th, those numbers will go back up again. So,
and sports and
sure,
clubs.
Right. Right.
Oh, yeah. Cycling, yeah.
Lisa?
I actually have a question for Brett.
I couldn't even see back there. I was not sure whether
you feel like you're off the hook. Okay, thank you. I wanna ask you because one of the items that's priority one here is CLS's big item, which is the elementary school teacher. And in the past, you've spoken eloquently and strongly in favor of keeping that placeholder in the budget. And we had to cut it previously, partly for monetary reasons and partly, in reflection of the population trend and the enrollment for the kindergarten. What I want to know from you now, having had that experience for the past year, is what's your take on how that experience has gone. I mean, do you feel now as though that's harmed the kindergarten program? I just want to get a sense of what the impact's been.
Well, I think, we were lucky because, I know I stood here last year and one of the things I do want to really acknowledge that I appreciate that we think in those terms. It's really been great. I mean, I've worked with Tom and Joe and you guys as a board to make sure that we have that, because it's an unknown, and unfortunately, it's a big unknown.
Yes, of course.
Of course. So I just love the idea that we've gotten to that point where we know it's an important thing to hold on to. And certainly last year, I did expect, only because of my past experience, and if you look at the kind of the numbers that are in my building, we're probably averaging about 72 kids per grade, somewhere in that. Mm-hmm. But this current kindergarten is really the smallest we have ever had in my time. We just got up. We had 58 as of earlier this week. This past week, we're actually up to 59. We have students going to come right after spring break. We're still low. Mm-hmm. We actually started the year, if I remember right, with 61. We had a couple of discharges and things like that. But I know, last year standing here, I would have bet that we would have been in the 70s somewhere. We're around the same number that we were last year. I know that we did a little bit earlier. I worked with Joe's office and my office to put our press release out a little bit earlier. We canvassed the normal preschools, things like that. Actually, I talked earlier this week because we're probably in the mid-20s still, maybe 26, something like that. Maybe a few staff members who are interested in bringing their children, which we, at this point we have space for it. So having that experience last year and thinking about the numbers where we are now, which is very similar to last year, I would say we'll probably get close to 60. I do expect around there, but I don't expect it to be much bigger. And it is really hard. I know it's something Tom, has tried to kind of do as far as estimates, but it's just very difficult to get
into those numbers. So that being said, I'm now kind of in a different mindset than I was last year because, you know, the most current kind of data shows that we're probably being around at around 60. I started to say earlier, I did talk to my my secretary, Elaine, and myself were talking about the possibility of actually adding an extra level of that advertisement by sending out to maybe some pediatricians that we know of that we work with in the building through CSC and other things. So we were thinking about actually sending that out too. So she was preparing something a little more than the press release to send out to them for this week. So by the time, you know, and then by, on a side note, we also didn't have as many over the summer last year that I would have expected that we had historically. So all that being said, I expect to be around the same numbers, probably around 60, maybe a little bit less, you know, a little bit more, and that would constitute three sections in K.
So if I can just follow up on that for a moment. One of the issues that we were talking about around this subject last budget cycle was what would the impact be going from classes that are, you know, have anywhere from 16 to 18 kids to 20 to 22 kids.
Right, right, right.
So what's that experience?
It's been manageable right now. Back in the, well, actually, no. Why I bring this thing with me. So we have, like right now, 19, 20, and 18. And those, well, actually one more, obviously, because of the number
right,
I mentioned. But
right.
That is manageable. We are lucky enough to still have been able to secure those aides, by the way, in kindergarten. So those are still in place, full-time aides, which I think is really a big, big piece of that level of success moving forward. To be honest, the numbers we had last year, and I can say very comfortably that all the data that Fern and I and my staff work in figuring out placement for the following year, you know, we moved that kindergarten class from last year into first grade this year, having made some of the best progress we've ever made. And there's a lot of reasons for it. I think certainly the 100% alignment with the Common Core and things have definitely helped that consistency in instruction. But kind of looking at the current group of kids, there are definitely more needs in this smaller group that are currently in kindergarten than we move forward into first grade. And then obviously you have those kind of variables where as you move forward, you know, certain things might come up when you get into first grade, and that certainly has happened. Unfortunately, that has happened in our current the largest current first grade class, where some behaviors, some things have come out that we didn't expect, and that class is, you know, like 21 or 20, 22 right now. And I actually correct myself, the other general ed class also has 22, so we're at 22, 22, 20, and 18. We've been able to manage, I think, the supports that we have in place that aren't on any chopping block, so to speak, are still in place, and it certainly helps. I've tried to even figure out in terms of my next smallest group, and that's something I've done in the past as well. Like, all right, so I have 59 coming from K to 1 for next year. The next smallest group I have is second grade going into third, and they're at 73 right now, because we actually also picked up a second grader who's going to start after a break as well this past week, which would get me to 25, 25, and an inclusion class of 23. And that, you know, albeit maybe manageable, is certainly not what, you know, the class sizes that we're used to, the class sizes we work with. So I'm still kind of bouncing back and forth as to whether or not, I know I'm getting a little further than your question, but bouncing back and forth as to whether or not, you know, we stick with three sections with the smallest group going into first grade next year. Those classes might be a little larger and hope we don't take on a handful of kids. Because I'll tell you what, I think that 59 in the current K will get larger as we, and probably get closer to maybe 70 at some point over the next several years as they go through every little bit of kids. And that really does what is happening. So I'm kind of, you know, we're it's early enough where we're thinking about it, but what does that mean for a first grade class? Now we're talking kids that are a couple of years younger than the next group that could be third grade. What would those numbers look like? And there we're looking at 2019, and that is manageable, but not forgetting that we do have, you know, there's some of the youngest kids in the building. Also not forgetting that they're one of those groups that just happened to come into the building, have some needs. Most of the other needs, estimate-wise, we have a more in the upper grades as far as that. So that's why we haven't seen a big drop. I think, you know, it's hard to kind of look at last year and this year because it's kind of apples and oranges, you know, that kind of thing. But I think under knowing that we have a series of supports in place, for example, those full-time aides in kindergarten really do help. And then Fern and I work with the staff to really utilize some of those supports that we have in teaching assistants and aides, and also the needs of those students, and figure out where it's manageable. I think one of the biggest shifts we're going to have this coming year that we haven't had to deal with is kind of prioritizing some of those in a group that might be larger and pulling back on maybe some other places. So we'll have to see, but I think it's been doable, it's been manageable, we've been working with it. I think it was successful, it was a good call on everybody's part, you know, in kind of holding that line that we didn't get up to that number.
And Brett, I hope you don't mind if I ask, but since Fern's sitting here, I was just wondering if there's anything from your experience working through this process that you want to add just to help us understand.
Thank you for asking.
And if you wouldn't mind stepping up here. Thank you.
I just want to say that Brett and I have been talking about this a lot because we're starting to look forward to next year. And so basically, he's channeled me with his. So he did such a great job.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Laura?
Thank you. That was a great explanation. I want to move into the other things you've got on your list, which are before and after school enrichment and homework and field trips. Let's start with field trips because I'm hoping that's the easiest question. This says it's a transportation line. So are you only cutting the transportation for field trips, which of course precludes them getting out of the building, but
right.
Tell me what your vision is, because all of these things are things that kids, you know, that enhance their daily experience of school. The before and after school things are a little different. You're zeroing out everything.
Yeah, as a possibility, sure.
As a possibility. So let's talk about what that looks like. Really.
Yeah, absolutely. And on the field trip side, most of that money has been, and when I first came, it was much larger, probably three times that size. You know, when I started 7 years ago, we kind of cut back and been able to, it actually is one of those rare cases where we've been able to add in a little bit. So that number there, primarily since we cut that larger number and have a smaller number over the last 7 years, it has gone towards transportation costs because we've been able to really take advantage of some of the great outside groups that we work with, you know, PTSO, Arts and Ed, RSF, even the Community Foundation has kind of helped in a lot of those ways. So the hope is that we would continue, you know, maybe utilize those a little bit more. Where the transportation piece comes in is, we have utilized those groups for some smaller grants, and then I take care of the transportation costs, so that's less. So it would probably, you know, one of the ideas would be we'd have to be more inventive with some of the field trips we've done. And I'll be honest, like some of the things where we used to go to a naturalist, we brought that naturalist to us, which is cheaper, there's no transportation cost. So we'd have to be inventive in how we do that, maybe rely a little bit more on some of the outside groups that have helped us in the past. I think that's doable, certainly with fundraising for those groups also have been something that's kind of dropped a little bit here and there, I know, in many of those groups. So the idea would be we would supplement it with maybe some more grants and things like that. We'd like to secure at least one, if not two, field trips per grade like we've been able to do, and certainly take a look at like our curriculum, what it connects to, and then where can we kind of cut costs, where transportation will be an issue, like bring it to the tower, which is doable in some cases.
Let me ask a follow-up question then.
Sure.
So it wouldn't be the intention then to ask parents to pay fees?
No.
I want that to be very clear,
yeah,
because there would be the possibility, right, that people would assume that there are either no field trips or only field trips if money is raised by parents or parents pay. So
right.
That isn't part of your vision.
No.
I just jump in and say that's, while it happens frequently in some of the school districts, that's not allowable under New York State law.
I didn't think it was.
Just saying.
I didn't think it was.
Yeah.
So I think it's important for...
It goes to that concept of a free and appropriate public
exactly.
education.
Exactly. Which is why I'm asking.
Yeah.
Because I don't want people to actually think that that's something that should be a cost that's assumed by...
Right. I totally agree.
Families.
There has been, you know, one thing I didn't mention, and there has been some talk with staff has come to me while we've talked about this as a possible cut. You know, which we haven't done in the past outside of big field trips, like, you know, fifth grade field trips and things like that. You know, is there some wisdom in the possibility of fundraisers that we do in the building with my staff, the Kids Night Out, for example? Mm-hmm. That could maybe help. So mm-hmm. that has been brought up, but yeah, never the other side of it kind of okay. right chance for the kids.
Thank you.
And on the other note, the homework help, that mm-hmm. kind of stuff.
That's a big note.
Yeah, that is, and you know, it really is. I mean, you're right. In all of these three kind of items are really over and above kind of enrichment stuff. Really, which really is one of the things, one of the many things that make this district great. And not to mention that, you know, this year I think I got the most amount of creativity in some of the enrichment programs, even down to on Tuesday. You guys will see that, you know, we're even getting a for fifth graders a coding type program, and with the intention of maybe as the years go on, including younger kids in that. But so that's, there's a lot of good ideas coming out of it. Again, some of the things that we've been, you know, that would have to be cut down. I know I have that as a full till cut. The hope is if we ever do get to that, maybe it won't be the 100%, but we might, you know, tease that down a little bit. That being said, there isn't obviously, as far as I know, as much funding sources outside to take care of enrichment programs like that. You know, field trips and things would be a little easier to do. Again, kind of the hope there would be that we'd be able to maybe hold on to some of these things, some of these enrichment programs out of the, I think it's a total of about 20,000 between the two.
So homework review, you consider enrichment, not?
Yeah, and it, I mean, like for example, we pay for the early morning math with that code.
Okay.
So it kind of bounces right. back and forth with which ones of those codes pay for that. But those are primarily my yes before, and actually in some cases in the past couple of years, after school enrichment programs.
Because your enrollment in those programs, as I remember from our start time research, is really robust.
It's great. We pretty much have a waiting list in every single one of them, in almost every one of them, yeah. So it's utilized.
Just to follow up, so with the before and after enrichment programs, that's the full budget. So that's like yearbook, I can't even think of them all, show choir, like that's,
yeah,
that would cut everything.
Show choir,
all of those.
STEM program in the morning, early morning math enrichment, book club.
There's the gym ones.
So, yep, the gym, yep.
So that would be all of that.
It would, that's how we pay for those things. And then some of the after school, last year it was, you know, that West had done the Shakespeare, which we were so glad to be able to do that outside the school day. And that was actually one of the things on a side note that I think shifted where we used some of that money to. It was the first time we had something so big after school. Now we, you know, this year we had the Roadrunners Club, which you guys approved, which was great. That came out of the same funding, things like that.
And so the homework review, is that just the math?
Not necessarily, and it kind of does vary a little bit. I know Tom works with me a little bit on how, where that comes out. So for example, I would think the graphic novel, thing that Nora did this year comes out of that.
And then the field trips, you know, if another organization didn't pay for field trips, you could do things in-house, but there would be, no one would be leaving the building unless someone else came up with that.
Possibly. You know, there are other pieces. You know, for example, we, you know, things I didn't mention, like other BOCES, for example, we pay for all that impact education stuff that doesn't cost us anything, where they bring.
Right, but as far as
like Star Lab and stuff like that.
Right, so, yeah, as far as getting the bus, there would be none of that.
That's right. Or we have to include that into certain grants. See if that
Rick?
And we're trying to protect the program here, so let's talk about the library part. Mm-hmm. It doesn't just put books back on the shelf, actually, as a participant in the program.
Yes.
So talk about that if you would, please.
Yeah, you know, it is one of the lower cuts, and when I start thinking about staffing and, you know, trying to prioritize that, I've had a lot of conversations with them, even over the years, because that has shown up here and there. Yeah, it is more than that. It's a lot of actually resources for teachers, managing a lot of that and working with them. You know, if we get to that point, I'd have to work with John and Ed to figure out how that would work between the buildings, because she is the senior person, so it is a little bit different. My vision hasn't been necessarily to cut that 100% from any of the three buildings. Like, we probably have more of a shared time frame. We haven't been able to sit down and discuss that, but I think there's a reason certainly to preserve that in all three buildings. It would just be less time.
If I could, thank you for your answers to these questions. One thing I'd like to add, in terms of the thinking in the back of my mind when I was putting this kind of reprioritized list together, is that depending on, and we looked at a bunch of different scenarios today.
Yes.
With piercing the cap, without piercing the cap, and I think it's good to look at all the possible scenarios. But depending on how deep or not the potential reductions might have to go, I was thinking similar to what Brett articulated in answering some of your questions, that I wouldn't necessarily just start with the priority ones and cut until we got to whatever the magic number was. Mm-hmm. I would be more inclined to say, if the magic number is X, maybe we only take 75% of the ones and 50% of the twos. So, that would be kind of having your cake and eat it too in a way, mm-hmm. which is also a reason that I group these by 12 discrete chunks and not by individual things, because it just, I can't wrap my head around doing it that way. But to look at a block of things that have a proposed reduction amount of 119,000 and say, all right, we cut half of that, then that leaves half of that. And then we go down to the next one and, maybe we cut half of that, that leaves half of that. So I think it's a little different way of looking at a 1 through 12 priority. That's my thinking anyway. But the bottom line is going to be the bottom line.
Yes.
And if we had to cut $575,000 out of our budget to close the gap, then we know what we'd be cutting.
Deirdre had a question, and Lisa?
Yeah, this is for Tom, actually, around the personnel clerk. So that position's empty now. I was surprised it was lower down in your priority list than I would have thought, because now I understand, particularly being on the audit committee now, the amount of work that your office does, and so I don't want to, I realize there are consequences not filling that position, but are there ways that you work with that, or is a half, I just would put out there, a half-time position maybe to do some of the work. I don't think it seems like your office can withstand like just taking on that position. It just came on because you were overburdened, but are there other ways to address that need?
Yeah, if you notice, it's not a 100% complete cut of the position. The idea was to be able to fill it in by either providing overtime for the employees that are in my office right now, or getting substitutes who have worked in our office previously who know the routines that go on. And it has, we've so far kind of spread some of what the person was doing previously into other people in the office, and they're taking over some of those responsibilities. So that position's responsibilities have already currently been spread out amongst the other people, and they've had to pick up this. They're mm-hmm. so far been able to do it within their workday, but they're really heavily worked. And the idea would have been to either potentially a half-time person, or to if they're going to take on the extra work, is to offer them additional pay to do it within their day, but they wouldn't get overtime to complete projects that were really a part of what that new responsibilities were. One of the big things was with the Affordable Care Act, and a lot of buildup towards it. It was a very difficult thing, but we got through it the first time. Tanya put a lot of work into it to begin with, but Liz took it over and did a tremendous amount of work over the past month or two to be able to, with the Affordable Care Act and these new forms that are going out. Unfortunately, there's a lot of school districts who can't even get one out. And luckily, ours are all out, everybody's, they're all mailed, and they should be receiving them. That we've come up with a way in which, since we've done it now the first time, it's going to be so much easier mm-hmm. going forward. It's that first time of doing it. just took tremendous amounts of time mm-hmm. to get it done the first time. But now that we've got it done, going forward, it's only going to be a quarter of the time now going forward as opposed to all the time. So some of the things that we used to do, some things are being farmed out now. Fingerprinting, we don't do fingerprinting anymore. So that was one thing right. that position did.
Right.
All they now is make the arrangements for you to do it as opposed to actually doing it. So, you know, we think we can manage within our office. So we've talked about it, and we think we can do it amongst ourselves, but they would be expecting increases in their pay to do that, or else we could go with a half-time person. Because we're going to need something. Those hours are there that need to be done.
Right now, the budget indicates some money either for somebody to come in to do it like we're doing it currently.
Right.
Meg Tedisco has been coming in for a few hours here and there to keep up with that. But the way we have it scoped out here, the money for a part-time person isn't there. It's only, you know, we reduced it from 63 to 18. So that's not a part-time salary. That's
quarter. But to follow up, it's down lower.
Yeah.
So just you were thinking around, well, when we get to an actual number, and if you draw from the different pieces, just one thought out there would be to, you know, make it a part-time position.
The fraction.
Again,
you know,
that would be consistent.
But move it up further
right.
in terms of a priority.
Mm-hmm. Lisa.
Okay. Brett, thank you. I have to say, you don't have to continue to stand up there. Unless you want to.
Just in case.
I just felt bad for you, Stan. No, I wanted to pick up on something that you just said, Joe, about, this is bad. You know what? Come back to me.
Okay.
I just went out
okay.
of
we'll
time.
Here.
Come back.
Go ahead. Maybe Diane.
So this, probably you, Joe, maybe Ed. So modified field hockey is on the list, and we haven't had a modified field hockey team in 2 years, so that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
When I think about going back to Steve's presentation about football, one of the reasons we've continued and looked to continue that program was we had kids in the program that were playing. Without a modified program for the last 2 years, I'm just wondering why maybe JV field hockey isn't on the list. That conversation has happened. There may always be kids that want to try field hockey at the JV level, but just different from the thinking we followed for football. So I'm just wondering if that's something that was on the list, having no modified program and low numbers. Kids that are currently there could play on varsity, and a lot of them will move up anyway.
Yeah. Well, at the risk of speaking for Steve, and Ed can call me a liar here in a minute, but my sense is that Steve has left the JV field hockey in the budget with the idea that maybe we would field a team, and we could be sitting here at the same time next year, and if there are no numbers, we could say, you know what, this is pretty much the death spiral of this program, so then let's cut JV, but at this point, as you said, cutting the modified stipend is a no-brainer, and we haven't had kids for a number of years, so that's just something we're carrying over from year to year, and we're in a position where we can ill afford to just carry over things from year to year. So that's the low-hanging fruit, if there is much of that in this list. So that I think that's his rationale, and Ed, correct me if or John, correct me if...
That's my understanding in terms of modified. And JV, Steve would like to preserve that because we're never sure about the numbers starting in fall. A couple months ago, more than a couple, I had some prospective parents coming in with ninth graders.
Mm-hmm.
Two, they play field hockey, would like to play field hockey. So it's a moving target in terms of those numbers. It's really dependent on, as you know, sign-ups. Sometimes we'll collapse JV and varsity into a varsity squad if there's not enough to sustain JV.
I mean, we also have a low enrollment and so many girls' sports in the fall, it's kind of a difficult.
Lisa?
I remembered what I wanted to say. Okay, so Joe, you were talking a few moments ago about the prioritizing process and, if and when we get to the point, more likely when than if,
mm-hmm.
where we have to start actually you know, going through the list with an eye to what cuts we're going to make so that we can bring our budget number down. What I was thinking about was something that I alluded to and when we were talking before about how Ed came up with his list of proposed cuts. I think that one thing that we might want to consider when we get to that point, which would be a little bit more work for you, but might be a different conceptual way to approach this is, you know, in most cases what we see on this list are reductions rather than outright elimination. And what we might consider is to look at particular items for outright elimination rather than reducing. Maybe there are some reductions we decide not to make as a partial offset, but you know, that is something that we should at least keep in the backs of our minds, you know, and not simply say, you know, again, going back to what you were saying, Joe, not merely approach this as a mathematical, you know, subtract, subtract, subtract. We might want to get a little more nuanced than that.
Can I ask a question, really more open-ended question, about athletic participation and whether or not there would be Title IX considerations that the district would have to take on board if you were actually talking about eliminating programs. I don't know what the long-term implications are of that, and it certainly would be great for us all to be advised of that if you were actually talking eliminations as opposed to reductions. Or. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I mean, it certainly has Title IX implications, and not being an attorney, you know, I'd be foolish to be giving you that kind of advice. But I know from time to time we've had to consult with our legal counsel about issues that could potentially have Title IX implications. On the other hand, in a particular situation, if you don't have anybody come out for the team,
no, of course.
If you offer it and there's no participation,
no, of course.
I don't think you're going to get whacked with a Title IX judgment, but if you're cutting a girls' sport and you're maintaining a similar boys' sport, all other things being equal, just for the sake of saving money, I think you're on pretty thin ice.
Yeah.
I mean, that's never been our approach to this, and I think we take great pains to make sure we didn't do that. You know, I'd prefer to cut both sports back some, so that they would be equal rather than deep cut one and right. not the other. And that's something I think we're pretty tuned into our Title IX stuff. So
mm-hmm.
I don't anticipate a problem there, but it's something we always have to consider, no doubt about it.
Deirdre, you have a question?
Yeah, I have an observation and a question. So just, you know, this sort of came up before. I don't know precisely what coaching staff we have for the different sports, but mm-hmm. I know at times with big numbers in certain sports, we've had coaches that do offense, defense, mm-hmm. or track coaches that do very specific mm-hmm. types of training and others. You know, I don't know all the makeup of the staff mm-hmm. at this point, but just I don't know if that's been considered. But obviously that seems like a potential thing, is you just don't have as many coaches, you preserve the sport,
right.
but you have fewer coaches if you're having fewer students participate. So that's my athletics observation. But the a question I have actually for Marvin, there are cuts from your department listed here. You've done tremendous work in addressing all the pressures of changing curricular responsibilities, data collection, and doing, you know, the most important thing, I think, of engaging our staff in professional development and curriculum development. There are cuts here, so I feel like I remember having conversations with you every year about this, but what's, you know, how is that feeling, the cuts that you have on the table? I mean, at what point, I know, you know, that's the richest part, it seems, of what you do is work with staff to develop curriculum, because all the rest of the data collection stuff, which occupies a lot of time, isn't really what helps our school district be as good as it can be. So I just want to get some feedback from you on the implications of the cuts you have here. Like the Aussie program, for example, is like a cut of maybe 50% time, and they've been with us for a lot.
Never a good idea to ask me how I feel about something.
Feel free. You're among friends.
In this current climate, I'll tell you what I think about it. How about that?
Yeah.
So I think about it like this. A lot of those things you just mentioned, curriculum project money and professional development money primarily, it's sort of like eating your seed corn. It's development money. So over the years since I've been here, which was about 16 years now, we've tried to evolve that budget up slowly, commensurate with needs for development. We've tried to calibrate those needs for development through the CEDA process. We've tried to bring lots of stakeholders together in meetings to identify strategic goals. So without talking about what's gone on in that regard, now here we are again, going through that same CEDA process again, identifying strategic goals around mission, vision, core values, and then concretely talking about outcomes for kids between now and, say, roughly 2022. So we're actually looking out that far right now and saying, well, okay, here, this is where we are now. A long-term strategic goal always involves all the kids in the district, so we're talking about development work across K-12, and we're saying to ourselves, what kind of capacity do we need to build in order to get kids where we need them to be by 2022? So the short answer to what you just said is, well, to the extent that we cut back on things like opportunities for teachers to write curriculum or opportunities for teachers to engage in professional development, then you're slowing down that process and putting us in a position where we'll have to prioritize and start talking about, okay, so what are we going to do first? What are we going to do next? An additional complexity in that kind of a question, too, is our friends at the State Ed Department, and I would say at the United States Department of Education as well, have not been kind to us in strategic planning regard, because they change things pretty rapidly. So nowadays, it's not like you can put things on a cycle and say with some predictability it's going to be this way or that way. I'll give you an example. At the last Board of Regents meeting, they voted to now review comprehensively all of the New York State learning standards and are going to put them through a revision cycle, reissue them, we anticipate sometime around next year, mid-year, school year, that we will have about one instructional cycle to recalibrate, get ourselves ready for a new curriculum delivery system with new assessments that we map to those new standards. So again, back to your question, if we have to back down on what expenditures we do have now, that will make us less nimble, less flexible. We're going to have to prioritize what we do. So just about the time you get a project sunsetted, a new set of projects are coming up over the hill that you've got to start responding, that you've got to put in place. So, I mean, that's the real short mm-hmm. answer.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Makes it harder for us to do that work. We just put out our summer curriculum, letter to the faculty inviting people to participate in that process. We engage them in the process of the CDEP, development. So people are aware of what we need to do. So faculty's been great about responding to that need and really saying, okay, this is from our point of view what we need to do next, and submit proposals. So now we're already thinking, gosh, we're going to have to sit down this time around if this budget situation remains, and we will have to prioritize what we can fund and what we can't fund. So we will be in the same position that everybody else is. What's the least bad thing we can do now, and what we think is the most important thing, so we'll do that at least, and then we'll put other things on the back burner. And that's how we'll have to respond.
Rick?
As you know, I'm honored to be on the curriculum committee, and I enjoy it a lot for a lot of reasons, partially because you're beguiling many of the time.
I haven't heard that word used in that relationship to Mr. Krebs.
It's true. It's because I was raised in Missouri. You're a beguiling bunch out there.
I'm old. I can say it. Joe may have also already answered this, so I'll finally get to a question here. There's also a $500 cut in your travel and conference, and while most of the time people would say, oh, I have a course, have to cut something. But you've just told us, and you've told us in frequent quite often, about changes that are constantly going. And at the same time in that committee, you'll say, and I was at a conference and I contacted, and that clarified my understanding of that. So I'm a little bit worried about even $500 cut.
That just means you'll have to take a bicycle instead of
I get a hoverboard, Martin.
Yeah, but then we have to buy the hoverboard.
How do you plan to do that, I guess? It's just the best way you can, your contact over things like phone, email?
Oh, it's a good question. I would say over the years, my job has, I've done less of that kind of thing. You know, getting on an airplane, flying to Chicago so that I can go to a national conference, that sort of thing. Most of what we do now is networking through professional networks. So I sit on a lot of these large, you know, regional or state things that I go to. So you tend to network a lot through them. And then professional development things as they come up. So far, we've been able to fund them through whatever budget lines I have. I think if you see anywhere where there could be potential problems, is if some big initiative comes out and I need to go to it for 3 days and we don't have money to fund it, that could prove to be challenging. At the rate at which they're changing things, I would anticipate that would happen. So that could be challenging.
I'd also say, though, and I agree with what you just said in response to Rick, but in that particular kind of situation, you will remember that we can transfer monies from one code to another code. So if Marvin were to come to me and say, I really need to go to Chicago for this conference, I'd be transferring out of my code into his. I mean, we'd make it happen if we had to make it happen. We wouldn't want to be knowingly leaving ourselves in the dark because we weren't able to be, to use your word, nimble enough within our own budgeting to make it happen. Make it happen.
I completely defer to Joe, Tom, and our president and vice president of the board, but I would sort of respectfully suggest that perhaps the board itself could reconsider its own travel and conference budget for professional development. There's been a cut there, but certainly the percentage is not as deep as the cut that your office is facing, and certainly we want to make it a priority for new board members who come on to receive training to understand the work we do here. But if we could be resourceful about using webinars or perhaps rotating amongst the members who goes to NISPA, I just want to put that on the table. I would like to see if, in fact, those kinds of choices are being made that we support
share.
The work that goes on of professional development in the district at the same level.
I'm not sure whether hand it first.
I'd go first.
Okay. Yeah, I totally agree. We haven't cut much out of our travel budget, and we should cut more because, you know, I'm the biggest professional development hound on the board, and I'm happy to give it up if it means that, you know, Marvin can go to conferences. I want to ask you about the Aussie number because you've done all the incredible ELA work. The curriculum is pretty well done. Does this feel painful to cut the Aussie consultant back by halftime? I know you were talking about phasing them out anyway because we have now created the curriculum and the staff may not need the support that they had traditionally gotten.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. It's a two-edged sword, so I'll set aside one side of it and just talk about the balanced literacy part. The Balanced Literacy Project has been going on for about, I don't know, 6-7 years. I'd have to go back and look at my records. Maybe 8 years. It's been a while. Let's put it that way. Mm-hmm. That came out of the last go-around of a serious comprehensive district education planning process. That was a full board effort to respond to issues in English language arts that were perceived by some data analysis that we did way back then. And it involved professional development, curriculum writing, particularly instructional improvement. The district kind of converged around this notion of a balanced literacy approach, which was the research-based best practice in the literature, so on and so forth. So our partnership with the Aussies, which now that we deal with the same consultants, but they're in a different company called Creative Services. It doesn't matter, the same people. So what's been happening over the years is that project actually evolved. It started out as a balanced literacy project itself to deal with instruction directly in the classroom, particularly around implementation of readers and writers workshop in a balanced literacy model. And it was mostly focused K-8, so that's kind of how it was set up. We had a consultant working in the elementary school and one in the middle school. Well, with the state education department, sort of back to this thing I was talking about before, and because they changed things, rewrote the standards, issued new standards, wrote more tests and so on, we had to actually take that project and pivot it toward curriculum writing. Because in this district, we have an affirmed value that the teachers should be engaged to write curriculum and directly engage with textbook selection, assessments, the whole thing, because we consider them to be the technical experts in their field, and we hire people who we respect their, their intellectual capital, if you will, and so we want to, capitalize on that. So we want them writing curriculum. So we kind of had the consultants pivot to start to support that work. So here's what's happened. As we've moved on, the Balanced Literacy Project has been pushed out as strong as it could be. The curriculum has been sort of written and it's in process. I think that's a little, a caveat to that is that's a you are never done file thing.
Absolutely.
Because curriculum is sort of one of those things that, it's not like Moses comes down and once you get it on the rock, you're good. It's one of those things that has to be continually updated. But I think the teachers can handle that without consultant support now, because I think they understand what we're looking for and they're pretty immersed in the standards themselves. So we've been kind of backing that down anyway gradually over the past couple of years. And I think next year, we probably would have backed this down a little bit anyway, irrespective of what was happening big budget. So here's the other side of that. Typically what we would do in a situation like that is we would be looking at opportunities to transfer that money toward other projects. So where it might hurt some is if we come out of the CDEP process, let's say, and again, I'm speculating right now because I don't really know where this is going to go, but let's say we said we were going to really pivot and start focusing on mathematics education, because that was important, and we were going to start to pivot some of those funds to support that by backing those funds down out of the BOCES budget, we won't have as much money to transfer to another project. So it could put downward pressure on our ability to, again, move to another project. So that's how I see that cut.
Okay.
I think it makes sense to me. I think it preserves some days in it for particularly the elementary school, because that seems to be where there is still some use of the balanced literacy consultant.
Thank you.
Lisa.
Marvin, thank you. I wanted to address Steve Jensen for a moment.
Good. He was next on my head.
And just
missed.
Thank you.
Thank
you very
Thanks,
much.
Marvin.
Hi. So I wanted to ask you about the cuts that are identified for tech. And I'm not so interested in asking about the specifics of the specific cuts, but because tech's been an important district goal and board goal, and because we've done a lot of work up until now to get our tech program to where it is with the expectation of building on that in future years, I want to get a sense from you on how what we're seeing on this list would impact that if we have to implement some or all of these cuts.
Sure. When it comes to e-software auditioning categories,
sure.
We are, every year at the end of the year, I always look at usage reports and seeing how much a certain piece of software, a certain subscription that we might have online is being used. And so a discussion has to be done then with the teachers with how often. For instance, Moodle, I'll just use that as an example. Moodle's used quite a bit in years past. There's Moodle down to where very few teachers use that program. So that's a coaster that we were looking at. Coaster has a litany of different services that it provides, and I looked at that particular coaster, looked at all the services, and the only one we used was Moodle. So then I began to look at that and targeting, and there's a winnowing out that goes on. Not that it's a bad thing to eliminate some, because there are some strengths to something like that, but there are other ways of doing that, and other ways of getting cost savings. If I have 3-4 teachers using something that's costing $2,000 or something like that, then we've got to find another way to do that. The other one, the other major one, obviously, is the boarding room that we talked about earlier today. Basically, what it's doing is just slowing us down a little bit. Smart bond money will be able to help offset some of that. And as we move into the high school, and the smart bond committee met, we had our first meeting. We're going to have a second meeting here shortly after the spring break, and writing up our proposals. And basically, there's a lot of things that, as Tom alluded to before, there are six categories, two of which don't apply to us: prepaid classrooms, and the other one was temporary classroom measures. So the other four do apply. And so we kind of went through that process, and I'm going to give you a really brief scenario of the agenda. But this is what we have, the state of the state of technology in Rhinebeck, and where we have some areas of deferred maintenance, things that happen on the back end. And I took them, as I said to that committee, I took them under the hood, opened up the hood, looked underneath. These are the things we need to do. And we know that after looking at that, we began then to see what we did on the instructional side, what we've done at the elementary, what we've done at the middle school, and now what we're looking to do at the high school. And the consensus of the committee, in the committee meeting that the high school needs to be addressed. And the high school is different than the other buildings, because there's such a diversity of disciplines that are being addressed. And so we want to take that, I guess I'm really summarizing here, but we want to take this in a considered response to that. In other words, we want to be able to make sure that what we do at the high school, we do it right. And so the idea of taking the smart bond money now and replacing some of the things that we already know we want to keep but need to be updated, whether it be some carts or some presentation technology, those kinds of things. And that will allow us then this next year to really plan out discipline by discipline. We're working with the chairs, Ed and I have met with the chairs, I think on two occasions that I think we have, about where we see technology going department by department. And I have a feeling, and it's just a feeling, in my opinion, that the response is going to be very diverse coming back because of the disciplines that they represent. Okay. So it's a much more complicated area to address than, let's say, the elementary. But so we're looking to take and use some of that smart bond money to offset some of the things.
So just if I can follow up on that for one moment. So one of the concepts that we've talked about a little bit this morning is if you take this item off now, you won't get it back. It's gone for good. So is that a concern that you have in terms of the cuts that we're seeing here?
The concern that I have is that the $41,000 is a lease. So that leases usually get embedded into the general fund. 3 years from now is when we're going to feel that hurt, that hit. We're not going to feel it in the next two years. It's going to be 3 years. I would go, oh, we had that $41,000 we cut 2 years ago. We don't have that renewed. Yeah, that is a concern. Mm-hmm. Again, it is 3 years out, and we're hoping that we can find other ways to address those issues and be able to do it. It's not an ideal situation, because I like things in leases, because what it does is it creates a renewal process. So budgetary-wise, I know that in 5 years I have some money, and over 6 years I have. And it's a way of making a commitment by the district to, let's say, technology in this case, like saying, yeah, as long as we keep our leases funded, we can do this. So yeah, so in 3 years, we'll feel that dip in the funding.
Okay, thank you.
All right, so.
Thank you.
Does anybody else have anything for Steve? Okay. So we've reached the end of our allotted time. Not that we need to, say time's up and that's the end of the meeting, but I'd like to try to be mindful of everyone else's time and try to wrap up in the next 15 or so minutes if we can. So if we have other questions, go ahead.
I don't have a question. I just want to make sure that I take this opportunity to thank everyone for being here this morning on a Saturday morning to just help us through this process. It's very useful. So thank you.
I'm good.
Right. No other questions. All right, I worked out better than I thought. All right, so one more opportunity. Go ahead.
Yeah, actually, I want to try to get back to the athletic discussion. So, and not specifically about field hockey, but
I guess I don't have a real sense of how much money is set aside or how the money is allocated to each sport. You know, obviously there are more expensive sports and less expensive sports, and there are some sports that have booster clubs and all that kind of thing. Is there a way that we can look at the athletic budget? They didn't come in with quite as high a list of possibilities for us to consider as the rest of the district has.
Well, I'll just stop you there for a moment. Mm-hmm. Somebody had asked that question of me and I responded to it. I did not ask the athletic department to come up with $50,000 of cuts like I did to each of the buildings and all of the district-wide programs. Mm-hmm. It's not a district-wide program. It's specific to primarily the high school, to a lesser extent, the middle school. So I don't want anybody to misconstrue that as, well, Steve didn't do what Joe asked him
right.
to do. I just said to Steve, within the context of the middle and the high school, look at your budget and let me know where we might be able to pare this back. So I just want to be clear about that.
Yeah, thank you for clarifying that. That's fair. But still, I'm a little, I just don't have any knowledge about how these sports are funded and if there are ways that we can consider some of them. You know, I'm looking at our swimmers who, you know, God bless them for starting their things, but there are not very many of them. So they have booster clubs, and we have, over the last couple of years, given them a little bit more money to support the program. Has there been consideration of speaking to those booster clubs and seeing what else can be done? You know, can we pull back a little bit, though? I know we hate to do that because they're trying to grow their program, but there are only an infinite, you know, a finite number of kids, right? So have those conversations happened? Are they under consideration? What are we doing about those guys?
Well, those, no and no,
okay.
But we can. Again, that's something that I was expecting to get some direction from the board around this table based on our discussion. It doesn't have to stop with 5 minutes from now when we all walk out of the room. I mean, mm-hmm. we'll be having these discussions for the next 5 or 6 weeks, but I mean, we can have that discussion. My understanding, and Tom, you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that Steve doesn't have all of these budget codes for each setup for each sport. That's just not the way it's ever been organized. Not that it means that's the best way to do it, but that's how he's operated. If the board or individual board members have certain programs that they want us to look at, we can probably back into them and chunk out where they're spending their money on. But I mean, to do that for every sport at this point would be a huge amount of work. And I think some sports, you know, we wouldn't even be asking the question, you know, they're, you know, take boys soccer or girls soccer for that matter. I mean, the programs are robust. They're heavily participated in. They're you know, they're no more or less expensive than anybody else. If we want to look at a sport that has low numbers, we can certainly do that and chunk the expenses out if that's what one or more board members want to see. I mean, we can back into those numbers you're asking about, but that's not how Steve has organized his budget, so.
Right, and really, I picked on swimming because it's the lowest number here. You know, there are other groups that seem to be sort of low. So are there more creative solutions to funding these athletic offerings? And it sounds like it's a bigger lift than just, yeah, we spend this much money on this group. And
we've done it before in the past. Uh-huh. Like you say, Steve doesn't particularly budget that way, but he does keep track of every single expenditure. So between our office and his office, we can come out and tell you exactly how much that program cost, like, last year.
Okay.
You know, but how much he, because his budget really has not changed over the years. It's like he's got like $14,000 for uniforms, and that's just what he carries over. In some years, he may be buying baseball uniforms, but the next 3 years, he's not buying baseball uniforms other than hats and socks. Mm-hmm. And then 4 years from now, that's what he's planning to get, new uniforms. So it varies from year to year as he goes through this. So he basically looks at his total budget and then determines which clubs need what, you know, which sport needs what. So.
Okay.
But we can definitely put something together.
And I think looking at the athletics department budget, I'm mindful of something Dr. Davenport said, that we don't want to be driven just by looking at the numbers that we were talking about, clubs and so forth, that it has to be kind of a complex, holistic picture. So we would certainly want to hear from both Dr. Davenport and from Mr. Boucher about, you know, their analysis of the situation with participation in sports. I would hate for us to sort of just take those numerical indicators as a benchmark, but also certainly in the time that I've been on this board, there was a moment when the district was able to provide more support to different groups that had robust booster clubs, and you know, maybe examining that calculus of how much the booster clubs bring and how much the district brings, that could be a conversation. I don't know if there could be some sort of fine-tuning of that. So again, we would need to hear from those who really work closely with those budgets. But I just want to second the thought that we should look creatively and in a holistic way at those expenses.
Diane?
Yeah, I mean, I think we have to look at the athletics a little more, like, you know, at chancellor level, you know, you're looking at removing all their extracurricular activities.
Exactly.
So, you know, certainly there is some from the high school when you talk about clubs, but not, you know, it's not the same. Cheerleading is on here. Is that something we still budget for? Because there hasn't been cheerleading in more years, and there hasn't been modified field hockey. So
it's changed from cheerleading to dance. What do they call that now?
No, I don't think that's the case.
No, there's a.
Yeah, I don't think that dance club. That's not.
That's not
out of Steve's budget.
Oh, well, then I got to move it out of there. Because I thought it was interscholastic.
Yeah, no. That's like 2012. No. There hasn't been cheerleading.
No.
So.
No. Oh, okay.
Cheerleading is, but that's not
that
cheerleading.
Not. So I'll have to move it out of.
So that might be a no-brainer, like the model.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'll definitely take a look at that. Thanks for grabbing that.
Go ahead.
Joe, I want to thank you for that prioritized list, mm-hmm. because it really does seem well considered. And I think we've identified some pieces here that people have questions about, you know, the cuts to chancellors after school programs, and there are other refinements, say, in athletics. But, you know, with all the moving pieces, and the tremendous amounts of money we have to cut, I think we're looking at a list that's been really well considered. So I just want to thank you for that, because.
Sure.
You know, I feel like we're kind of moving in a direction, and of course we just have to really, you know, the biggest piece is something completely or mostly out of our control, which is state aid, and hope with it we can find that. So, and you know, I'll just say personally around athletics, even though I think it's a good idea to get, you know, we may need to cut into athletics more if the worst case scenarios come true. What are, say, the really low participation number sports? What are those budgets, which probably really aren't very much in the big picture, but they add up. But I just want to say, you know, to Rick's point early on about, like, what are our values as we go into this and valuing people, you know, it really is just so impressive the amount of engagement our students have from the elementary age up through the high school in so many variety of things. I think it makes the overall educational experience so valuable. What you do during the school day, you know, and after school impacts the whole sense of community you have. And if you want to be here because you can't wait to go to swimming afterwards, then maybe you're more attentive in your history class, you know, which is less interesting to you in you know, in your core. So I just think it's all of a piece. And so that's why I want to just also thank you for how thoughtful mm-hmm. the cuts are, because I think they do reflect values that add to, you know, that keep our core values.
Thank you.
Just going forward, just will you be tweaking this list based on today, or
what's next?
Well, I think what's next in part, we know that there are some things that were on the scenarios that Tom put together
that I would suggest we move forward and do, like use the $40,000 from our, from our workers' comp fund. Yeah, the, to me, those are no-brainers. Others are question marks still, and we're going to have to wait till all questions get answered. I mean, we'll have a discussion about the discussion this morning amongst our administrative team, and I mean, some people have raised some good questions. We'll talk about those. As I mentioned earlier, I think the final decisions are going to have to wait till we know what the final picture is, because that's going to be our bottom line, and then we have to make the tough decisions as to what gets cut and to what extent gets cut. And I'm not sure we can really do that sitting here today until we find out how the rest of that's going to pan out. But it's been a good opportunity to think through some of these things and to listen to the the input from our administrators. That's why, in my opinion, today is so critical. It's an opportunity to get them all here. Granted, it's taking time out of their time with family, etc., but it's very useful to hear their feedback. And to be honest with you, if there is a question that persists after today, we can bring one or more of them back. I mean, they're with us once a month anyway, many of them, so it's not like we'll never get a chance to talk to them after this morning. So if there's a need or an interest, let me know. We'll bring them back for a command performance. But I think we've got a lot, there's a lot of food for thought here, and I think some of the directions are pretty clear. Others, we're going to need to wade through it as some of these other numbers, in my opinion, get firmed up. Mm-hmm. Are we cutting $490,000 or are we cutting $289,000?
Right. Right.
There's a huge difference in how you go at that, mm-hmm. depending on whether you're cutting here or you're cutting there. So that's a lot to say about that. And the last thing I would mention, maybe the last thing, maybe not, is that thanks to some feedback from some board members and requests from a parent, I have put up on our website, and Tom will be emailing out, if not this weekend, certainly on Monday, kind of an overview of our budget process and contact information for our state legislators and our governor. So if people are inclined to pick up the phone or send an email or a letter saying, hey, we're going to have to cut our programs because A, our tax cap is constraining us, and what you're giving us on the state aid side is constraining us, help us. And by the way, we vote for you guys, so mm-hmm. That, and we talked about that earlier in the year,
yes.
that kind of grassroots advocacy on the part not only of us, because we've been doing it, but on the part of individual community members or staff members is
yes.
going to be important. They start getting a bunch of phone calls and letters, they will take notice. And now is the time to do it.
Yes.
Because they are grinding down on the last several weeks of this budget adoption, mm-hmm. and they hear from people now that may help us.
Okay.
So that's all I have to say about that.
All right, so I think we can wrap up. All right, thank you all in the audience for being here today. It's really helpful for our administrators to provide their input, and for the members of the public that are here to observe and take what happened here today out to the rest of the members of the public. That's great. So we do have a meeting on Tuesday. So we'll see you all then.
Do we need a motion to adjourn?
Yes, we do.
Yes.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
Yeah, all those in favor? That's unanimous. That motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.